Now, what exactly does an indie filmmaker do when they're thrown a curveball, like, trying to make an indie movie during a pandemic? Welcome to the Film Threat Podcast. I am Chris Gore. You know, it is my mission in life to talk to you about independent films worth checking out, and then to talk to those filmmakers to hear about the process, how they got their films made. And I'm really excited to talk to the filmmakers behind Single Mother by Choice, which is currently playing on HBO Max. Before we do that, I want to say thank you to everyone that has come to the Film Threat YouTube channel, supported us. Please like this video if you like it, share it, subscribe to the channel. Get it out there, and check out some of the other content we have. We've got some amazing interviews with independent filmmakers. And if you like the t-shirt that I'm wearing right now, you can get one like this. Support us and buy something at shop.filmthreat.com. All sorts of Film Threat shirts, a lot of stuff geared towards filmmakers or film fanatics and film fans, which are, I guess those are my kind of people, right? Like everyone that I talk to is pretty much a film fanatic. But I'm ecstatic today to talk to the filmmakers behind Single Mother by Choice, Dan Levy Daggerman and Selena Ringel. Welcome to the Film Threat Podcast. Thank you for being here.
Thank you
Thanks so
for
much.
having us.
Yeah, thanks so much for having us. Love the shirt, by the way.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah.
It's sort of a take on a logo for one of my favorite, I guess, an indie movie. The Empire Strikes Back technically was an indie movie. George Lucas being probably the most successful independent filmmaker. But this movie, I love the movie, just to talk to my audience for a second, is about a woman who's an agent working in life, wants to have a baby, gets pregnant, and is going to have a baby, all with the chaos of the pandemic happening around her. And Selena, you were pregnant in the movie. I mean, like, this is not like a, you wove in aspects of your life. So how did this project come about? Did you just decide, hey, I'm going to do this and kind of document, my pregnancy, but then also weave it into this really heartfelt story?
Thank you. Well, actually, so it was actually Dan's idea. So I had been doing a lot of acting and I had been doing stand-up and performing. I was at the Groundlings. We have a production company together and we've always been, writing and producing together. He's a director. And so I had been taking on like this whole like alternate side of my persona, which was this performing side of myself. And I was loving it and I was doing really well. And I really, really wanted to have a baby. And I remember Dan saying, "Well, when you're pregnant, it's going to be really hard to book roles because, unfortunately, the way it works is that once you're pregnant and it's visible, it's like there's things you're not like there's just like a whole thing behind that, right? That makes it difficult to book things." So he said, "What if we made a movie that actually tracked your pregnancy in real time, kind of like Boyhood, where we film once a month and we include aspects of your real pregnancy into a written narrative that we come up with?" And I was like, "Wow, that's so brilliant." I was like, "That's such a good idea."
So it started for me as I was like, I have this really crazy idea, might not work. And then how it works with Selena, she jumped on it and was like, oh, that's brilliant. We should do it. So the idea came about kind of August 2019, I think.
Yeah.
And we were shooting by October or November.
Yeah. So what ended up happening, that was actually very difficult, is so we started filming, we were in development, and then we started the production, and I actually had a miscarriage, which was awful.
Sorry.
Yeah, it was like one of the worst things I've ever been through, but it was also like so vulnerable because we were like making this whole movie around me being pregnant, and never in a million years did I imagine that I would have a not viable pregnancy once I was pregnant, like, which I'm sure is something that has happened to millions of women that we just don't talk about. So then it was like,
I hate the mechanic basement, but with Realtor.com's 3D tours,
wait, what?
I can explore the
What?
world virtually. I love my new home.
I don't know where that came from. That's
Where did that
bizarre.
come from? A little cameo appearance.
Sorry about that.
No.
Anyways, as you were saying.
So as I was saying was, then it took a lot for us to kind of sit down and be like, do we really want to do this again? Do we really want to start filming again? Because I had to obviously go through a lot emotionally to get myself back to, you know, I was very early on. So in that sense, I was very lucky. My miscarriage was very early. So it wasn't something where I had to go into some sort of procedure or anything. But it did kind of really throw it back at us. Like, you want to film your pregnancy? Like, okay.
Yeah, you know? Definitely raised the stakes a lot.
Yeah. So then I remember telling Dan, I was like, you know, if we're going to do this again, I don't think I'm comfortable starting until I'm around 3 months pregnant, because I feel like if I start before that, I'm putting myself in a situation where I might be going through too much emotionally. And I don't know if I want to handle that. So then we start filming again, what we thought was going to be before she's pregnant. Okay. So we were like, before she's pregnant, we'll film, then we'll wait until the 12-week period. And then we start filming that weekend. I'm like already not feeling
Brittany
well.
Turns,
And Brittany, who's my co-star, and she's has like a little bit of like, she can like feel things or something. She like comes up to me. She goes, Selena, you're pregnant. You're going to have a little boy. I was like, what? She was like, I think you should go get tested right now. I was like, no, I don't think that's possible. And then I did. I took a pregnancy test that night, and it turned out I was already pregnant. So I was like, oh my God, here we go again right away. You know what I mean? So it was like, and then, but we never in a million years thought there was going to be a global pandemic. Our movie had nothing to do with the pandemic. It was it was a movie about a woman who's tired of, you know, looking for the right man. And she really wants to have a baby, and she's a, you know, a little bit of a workaholic, and she feels like she can handle doing this on her own. And this is actually a movement that is growing across the United States called Single Mother by Choice. We've spoken to the organization, and it's this incredible thing where women are, you know, saying, I'm hitting a certain age and I want to have a baby. So I'm going to go through sperm donation and I'm going to do it because I don't want to keep waiting and miss my window. So initially the movie was about that and a woman who kind of does this with her best friend.
But then now Selena was pregnant. So it wasn't like the 3 months prep we had, and then we'd take 3 months off and dive into it. So now we were sprinting, we're making a movie. And the way we had designed it was we're going to shoot 10 minutes each month. And, you know, 9 months makes a 90-minute film.
Yeah.
And so it was just off to the races. And then, so like Selena said, come end of January, February, COVID's hitting and we had to figure out what to do.
And March, you know, I remember we had a gender reveal in March, and it was like all of a sudden they were, you know, shutting down the borders of Europe. And they were saying like, this is now like a real, like the whole world is kind of like shutting down right now, you know, and everyone we spoke to was like, well, obviously this is going to last 2 weeks, you know, what you should just stop filming and start it back up again when COVID is over in 2 weeks. And so
we had our entire March shoot planned. We had to cancel that. We had just cast Vanessa Angel as Selena's mom.
Yeah, we had 25 people on our crew. But, you know, I was really pregnant. So it was like we couldn't actually put me or my baby in danger.
Because now it's the zombie apocalypse. Like,
and there's no vaccines. I mean, like, we also have to remember that this was the beginning of the pandemic. Like, this actually felt like the end of the world. Like, if I've ever felt that, you know, like, it was not like...
I will say the way that you handled the movie felt really real because you captured that era. I mean, you really captured that era. Like, I think at the beginning, people were really scared and whatnot, and not as if that has gone away. But I mean, I think we've learned how to deal with it. But you really captured that era like so perfectly, like those early days of not knowing and wiping down your groceries and things like that, that, you know, I don't think any of us do that anymore. We know it's airborne, right? I'm not a doctor, but I'm just saying, you know, I read stuff. And so you really handled it well. I mean, it actually raised the stakes. I mean, I don't know what you envisioned the movie to be before. I mean, you gave me some tape, but I really think that you worked it in perfectly because it just raised the stakes of conflict.
Yeah.
Thank you. By nature of the structure of how we designed like making the movie. So it hit at just the right time, the pandemic, for making this movie, because it was like the break into act two, you know? So it hits at just the right time in terms of the structure. We had to throw out a lot of stuff and adjust and make it all work.
Yeah.
But we found that was the right timing for it. It drove us insane, the process, because we were writing in real time.
Yeah.
So the feelings that you see on screen are what we were experiencing. So you get such a visceral experience of the time capsule of what that year is through making the film, you know?
Well, and also, like, we were literally, we were writing, we were shooting, and we were editing every month throughout my entire pregnancy, which is insane. And we were also trying to constantly figure out how to write the next piece without knowing what the world was going to be like, if things were going to open, if I was going to be able to shoot something with another character, if we were going to have to do it on Zoom. Like, it was the most on the fly, like, filmmaking experience of our life, because we're so used to, you know, we both went to AFI. We have a master's degree. We're like, we know how to organize everything, but, like, I have charts and schedules and budget, you know, it's like, and this was like, we just had to fly by the seat of our pants and just figure it out because there was no other version of continuing. And I remember there was a point where, you know, we thought, well, the only way to keep making this movie is to include the pandemic. And we had so many people say, you know, that's a terrible idea. No one's ever going to want to watch anything about this time in history once it's done because it's so awful. But we just felt like, this was our chance. Like, this, what we loved about this concept was that my pregnancy was real. And we thought, what a unique experience to really capture this in real time. And some people said, oh, well, you know, you can pretend she's pregnant later and figure out a different way to thread this story. And we were like, no, that doesn't feel right to us. Like, what feels right to us is to really embrace, like, the world is changing in, like, a massive way. Like, what if we just put that in? What if we just made that a part of the story?
It really works well and lends an authenticity. And I think it reminds me of, you know, sort of what independent film does best, right? Which is, you know, take a situation and actually make it real. I mean, the real moments, you know, the doctor visits, the anxiety, all the, you know, the stress that comes with it. I mean, I was a young dad at one time. So I've been on the other side of that. And, it's, you know, it's nerve-wracking. It gets better. I have two kids. So on the second, it's maybe less stressful because you're like, oh, I've been there. I know what that's like. But your experience really just felt so real. And using that, I just think was amazing. How did you get HBO Max interested and broker that sale? Because I've noticed lately they have really been, at least to me, it seems they're getting more aggressive about independent films, bringing more independent films onto the platform.
So, well, I want to shout out our manager, Doug Warner, who did an amazing job. He was the person who brokered the deal. To be totally honest with you, we were about to go with another deal that was, you know,
not the same.
It was a completely different deal. Yeah. I mean, it was like HBO Max was like
was our dream. That's
the real deal. Like, that's the deal every independent filmmaker is looking for. But we were about to sign something else. We felt very discouraged. We didn't know what was going to happen. We felt like we had put so much energy and time and effort into something that we thought was really unique. And it was like,
and we also wanted to get it to market really fast too.
Yeah. We wanted to get to market really fast. We like wanted to not do the whole festival thing or whatever, because, like, we just felt like right now, this is either relevant right now or it's irrelevant. Do you know what I mean? I think now, because the pandemic has actually become like a global thing that's shifted the world, I actually believe this movie will be relevant forever, because I believe that this is now like a moment in history that shifted the world. At that time, we didn't know what it was going to be. So we were just thinking, oh my God, this has got to be a pandemic movie that comes out during the pandemic, or I don't know what this is. Do you know what I mean? So we were trying to move very fast, but HBO loved it. And which was very exciting. And Doug was the person who said, you know, if you're going to be looking at making other deals with other people, make sure that you put, you know, a clause that you can kind of you can turn down their deal if you get some of these five major streamers interested. Because he was trying to tackle these like five major streamers. And then
one other thing I think is really interesting to note is how we were thinking about festivals a little bit, but then with the whole festival world changing with the pandemic, we had a few shorts that were in some, and the whole virtual experience was very different from in-person experiences. So we were taking a step back and looking at that. And then some of the larger festivals where films actually get acquired, they seem to cater towards more A-list stars and actually like mini studio movies.
Yeah.
So we didn't feel like there was like a place for what is very, very small indie film, you know, that is, you know, telling the story.
Yeah, and you know, it's interesting because I'm actually going to shout out someone else called Dan Mervish, who just wrote a really amazing article on Variety. Oh, do you know who he is?
I know Dan for years.
He's amazing.
He's amazing. And he just shouted us out, actually, in his interview. I mean, in his article, in his article that he wrote in Variety, which we thought was super sweet. But basically, he kind of highlighted that the whole kind of festival circuit has shifted so much in terms of what it means to be at some of these, you know, bigger festivals and what it means to do it online and how COVID has changed everything and how some of these really like massive movies are now premiering at Sundance. And what does that mean for people like us who are making these indie films? Because then all of those slots are not available. So it's like, and basically, you know, he shouted us out in the context of saying like, here are two people who did things a completely different way and just sold directly to HBO Max. They're all fair. Every way is fair. Right. You have to figure out what makes sense for your movie.
I think so. I think that like every filmmaker sort of has their own pathway to success, so to speak. And I will say that I think this is, it's sad for me to say this because I wrote a book about film festivals, but it's, I think festivals have become less relevant now with internet and now with like streamers that are just looking, you know, for movies. It's, I just think that festivals is, there's other pathways than going to a festival. And Dan, I agree with you, the virtual festival thing, I'm not super jazzed about it. I like it as an addition to a live in-person festival. Mm-hmm. Like Slam Dance is offering, I think it's like $10. You can actually watch all the movies that are playing at Slam Dance when it happens, you know, because it's virtual this year or in 2022. Yeah. Right. Yeah. So, I argued recently online that they should just shift the entire calendar and Sundance and Slam Dance should just be in the spring or summer, you know, let's get out of flu season, because what you benefit from, and you didn't need this, but a lot of filmmakers do need the in-person screening. They need that feedback and, you know, to kind of find an audience. I think the audience for your movie was very, very, I mean, not that maybe you had this in mind, but I feel like the marketing of the film was really smart down to the title, right? Like, it's like, you know what it is. It's like, and if you've seen the trailer, if you've not seen the trailer, check it out, but also it's on HBO Max, but it's just like really like, the title sells it, right? Like, I mean, it's, and it's also like the fact that, and also the hook being that it's real. I am curious about some of the other scenes, like, you know, your doctor visits. Was that real? And did you recruit, or were those planned out, acted out scenes? Because a lot of it just seemed very, you know, real to me.
Well, I think, well, I kind of call it like a docu-narrative. Like the way we kind of did it was, no one's real voice or face was used that was not a part of the film. So what we would do is if like, say, for example, I had a doctor's appointment, I would go in, we would film me, we would re-record everybody else, right? So, but I was actually at a doctor's appointment sometimes. So it's like the way we did it was we tried to make sure we weren't, you know, breaking any of the rules, but we were still kind of getting real moments. And then sometimes we would recreate certain moments if we didn't feel like we could actually catch them. It was a lot of like technology, you know, like me, you know, me calling Dan on his computer, him screen recording it from his computer.
Yeah, there was one moment I felt like a total spy. I wasn't allowed into appointments. So I'm like sitting there on my computer, sending Wi-Fi to my computer from my phone, screen recording, you know, doing the whole thing. And then we replaced my little FaceTime box with the actress's FaceTime box and stuff like that, you know?
Wow. It had that authenticity. And like I said, I've been on the other side and through that experience, and it really felt real. I mean, it's hard to like, I mean, I don't know how you top this other than maybe having another baby. I don't know. Like, do you have any other projects that you're working on currently?
Yeah, so we actually just got hired to write a script for a pretty big influencer, and we're very excited about. So we're doing that right now. We can't say who it is yet, but he's really, really funny. The movie's completely different tonally. It's kind of like in the tone of Barb and Star Go to Mar Vista or Zoolander. It's like this larger than life movie. that I think is hilarious. And we're working on that right now. We're super excited to have gotten hired for that project. But as far as independent film goes,
well, we've got a stoner sci-fi movie in the works. We'll see if more things happen with that soon. So that's a lot of fun.
Yeah.
Awesome.
We have a lot of stuff that's like in good shape that we're also pitching all the time. You know, we have some stuff that I'm half Mexican. I have a couple projects in Spanish that I'm trying to set up in Mexico. We have, you know, I'd say probably like together, we have around like 10 projects that are like ready to go right now that we're like in different stages of pitching and figuring out the financing.
So we started dating in AFI and we started our company before we got married, and we've just been developing nonstop since then.
Yeah.
And so we've just been doing that, and we shot our first feature in between before this one. That's the best people. You can check it out on Amazon.
Yeah.
And we have a bunch of stuff that's quite developed, and we're just trying to get it to market.
Yeah. But I mean, in the meantime, we you know, got hired to write this movie. So that's been really cool. But I do think, you know, I do think to myself, like, wow, this was so personal and unique. I don't know. It's funny. Like, I don't know how much more personal and unique you can get. You know what I mean? Like, it was like, we really went there. Like, there's like a moment in the movie where like literally my baby is kicking inside of my stomach, and like, that's my real baby kicking inside of my stomach. Mm-hmm. And we were able to capture that. Like, I don't know how you get more personal than that, you know? And we included miscarriage in the movie, you know, when we read it, because we just thought this just happens to too many people and people don't talk about it. And it just needs to be something that's not taboo, because it's something that's not explored enough. And it's a super, I think, important conversation for women to have and for women to feel like they're not alone while they're going through it. So we really went there. We were like, let's just take everything and just put it on the camera.
and as filmmakers, it was so liberating to make this movie as well, because I'm so used to doing everything by the book. Keys in every department. And I love collaboration. I mean, that's like why I got into this, to work with just top people to make the best product you can. But then, you know, shout out Maddie and Tam, who are the DPs through most of the film until I had to take up the camera when it was just the two of us. And they really taught me how to continue making this movie. We couldn't have done it without them. We grabbed the camera and I had tutorials, and then just like, it was the two of us.
We literally made probably like 70% of the film, the two of us, just the two of us. Yeah. Wow. Because we couldn't risk having anybody else with us. Granted, everybody was so helpful. And so, I mean, everyone in the crew was amazing, and they just wanted to come back to set.
Like, we all wanted them.
But... And we wanted them, but I was pregnant. We couldn't take the risk. So they were like, what if I wear a mask? What if I, you know, stay outside? What if I, and we were just like, but what is, at that time, we really didn't know what the risk was. Like if I got COVID, what could happen to the baby, you know? So we just had to really lock it down and be like, I'm sorry, but no, but let's have calls and let's, you know, try to figure things out together without having you guys here. So that was really tough.
Well, the movie is really inspirational, not just, you know, what happens in the movie, the events of the movie, but just the way in which you went about it. So congratulations on the success of Single Mother by Choice. And thanks for being on the Film Threat podcast.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much for having us.